And now the tough labor market for younger workers. A new report finds underemployment among recent college graduates, that is, young adults working in a job that does not require a degree, has jumped to 45%. The terrain is especially rough in the arts these days, as NewsHour economics correspondent Paul Salmon learned, part of his reporting on making sense of financial news.
Gustav Mahler's Fourth Symphony, conducted by James Gaffigan, played by the orchestra of perhaps the world's foremost college of the performing arts, Juilliard, which costs $55,000 a year to attend. Though many are still undergrads, these kids make world-class music. No surprise, since they're immensely talented, and most of them have been practicing practically all day, every day since they were tots. And were admitted to one of the world's most selective schools, some Juilliard departments have less than a 1% acceptance rate. So, what are the job prospects of some of the world's most gifted and motivated young college grads?
For any orchestral opening in the United States, you might have, for one violin opening, 300 people applying that are all completely qualified to do that job. And that's how competitive it is in the audition process.
So, performing arts schools, including the most famous of them all, Juilliard, are taking a new approach.
Support our friend Peter.
Now don't panic. Juilliard isn't hitting you up for money, nor is PBS interrupting this story with yet another pledge drive. Yes, Bill Baker, former president of New York's public television station, WNET, is a pitch man, but since retiring from TV and knowing a thing or two about raising money, especially for the arts,
more.
He has taught Juilliard's very first course in the basics of business for performing artists.
It's like suddenly trying to teach them Chinese. They'd never thought of numbers being associated with what they do.
But is their attitude towards business also that it's kind of
dirty? Yeah, there is a little resistance to that. And when I say the performing arts is a business, a number of my students recoil. A business? This is art. And I try to explain that, yes, it is an art, but it also is a business. And they have to understand that if they're going to make it. It's that simple.
Can you make a living these days as a musician without significant entrepreneurial effort?
I don't think so.
Conductor Diane Whitry.
But the challenge is, how do you balance, you know, doing marketing for yourself and all these other things and still keeping up your art form? How do you make a website? How do you make a demo tape for an audition? I think the schools are now beginning to expand the training and realize that entrepreneurialism is the answer for the future.
I try to explain to them that if they go to an event or a party and they perform and everybody applauds and they go back exhausted into their dressing room, that's a big mistake. They have to come out and associate with the people that were applauding to them.
It is then, says Bill Baker, who ran WNET for 20 years, that an economics mindset can make all the difference.
Mostly because even a billionaire can't fathom someone who is that disciplined, who is that gifted. And that's where the magic comes in. That's where these students don't often realize that they have magic.
And that they can translate that magic.
They can translate that magic into support.
In this day and age, perhaps even more than in a very long time, they had darn well bet.
The visual art market is one of the more peculiar and difficult markets to, you know, to understand and track.
And the art world is just too big an amorphous term. You know, there are many art worlds. There is the art world of the Middle East. There is the art world of Asia. There is the art world of, you know, China versus Korea versus Japan. And then there's the art world in Europe. And in many instances, things don't cross over.
I mean, look, the world art market as a market is small. According to the European Art Foundation, it's about $51 billion a year. Total art sales worldwide. Now, around half of that is assumed to be coming from commercial galleries. That's around 26.5 billion euro a year. And around 10 billion of that comes from art fair sales.
The pool of wealth in this world is growing exponentially, and people are using culture as a way to signify their arrival.
Of the other half of the world global art sales, around 26 billion, you know, around two-thirds of that to a half is coming from auction sales.
The auction houses have become very influential in setting standards, and they've really taken over the art market in a large, to a large extent.
I mean, you know, the prices have skyrocketed, as you know, it seems like an inadequate term, but people really pay attention to auction results because they're so impressive.
Many artists have negative associations with business, you know, in particular with the idea of sort of quote-unquote selling out. And so there's a sense that, you know, you went into the arts so that you specifically wouldn't be part of the business community. So one of the things that we try to do is to say, first and foremost, thinking like a business does not mean that you are selling out. You expand outside of your own community. You'll have opportunities to connect with people who can help your career, who might be interested in what you do in your country. And you know, most artists in New York that I've met are looking for opportunities to get outside of New York and, you know, and see other places and find new markets for their work.
You know, if you're asking us to commit our resources and our energy to supporting your work as an artist, I want to know that you're fully engaged and that you get it. Because it's you know, that's part of it. I wouldn't necessarily be the place to show an emerging artist. That's not what we do really well. What we do well is we can take an artist who's already been at these younger galleries and we can bring them to the next level. And then they become known to curators who are not economically motivated by, you know, is this saleable?
There are many, many existing platforms online that look to support and show artists, from Saatchi Art through to ArtNet, through to Paddle 8, through to Artsy, through to ArtSpace, but very few of them actually sell art online. So it's very, very difficult to get the kind of pickup in search and social that gives you the amount of traffic you need in order to publicize what it is you're doing and connect with buyers.
And I think that in today's market, so much is done on the internet that personal connections are really important. So it's important for gallery owners and for artists to make personal connections and develop relationships rather than relying on everything being technologically transmitted.
I think there's always an opportunity. There's a huge undercurrent of social networking at the art fairs. People go there, they see all their friends, they see other collectors, other museum curators, journalists. So it's a huge, it's kind of like the town square of the art world, so to speak. And where all the heroes and the town folk congregate to experience the buzz and the electricity of the art market.
So I think that artists tend to build communities with other artists that are in the same genre of work that they are. And it's a very good way of bouncing off ideas, sharing ideas, exploring, opening new areas. I mean, if you look at, for example, the group of artists in Europe during the period of Cubism, Picasso and Braque exchanging back and forth and bouncing ideas around, you feed on each other and you help each other grow. So I think for the artwork, that's important.
Opportunities to get your work seen, get residencies, get training in the skills for being an arts administrator, a curator, apply for a program somewhere. The entire system
needs to be brought up together. And by that entire system, I'm looking at arts education, the Ministry of Culture, individual patrons and art collectors, journals and spaces for critical dialogue, the different levels of development of art scenes can be a really exciting way to share knowledge, where the educational space, the government support, the independent arts sector that promotes the critical discourse, the kind of freedom of expression kind of aspect, and the patronage, collecting, commercial space work together.
I think art, like most forms of cultural activity, is about telling stories. And it's about narrating the experience of individuals in real time. So it's a form of lived history.
It is a platform for dialogue about the private lives of people, the private thoughts of these people who are so far away and so alien in our minds.
I think it makes me more open and maybe more compassionate in an area that I might not have been, where I thought maybe I was, but there's certainly room to grow.
I'm interested in art that ends into a richer cultural story that happens to be beautiful.
Artists are among the most perceptive people in sort of interpreting the world. And I've always thought, you know, that visual arts in particular have an immediacy that you can't duplicate with anything else.
I think artists tend to be a seismograph for things in the future, whether they're cultural trends, cultural perspectives. Artists somehow have their ear to the rail, and I think they foreshadow the direction of human endeavor.
I think that, and this is certainly not true of all artists, but many artists have negative associations with business, you know, in particular with the idea of sort of quote-unquote selling out. And so there's a sense that, you know, you went into the arts so that you specifically wouldn't be part of the business community. So one of the things that we try to do is to say, first and foremost, thinking like a business does not mean that you are selling out. You know, there's a lot of fantastic research that has been done in the business community about how to organize your work, how to sell it, how to manage your money. That you can take those lessons and learn. So, just from a best practices and research standpoint, there's really nothing but good things that you can take from the business world. I think actually law is a very big one. To a lesser extent, finance. But I think in particular, people don't know a lot about you know, what kinds of protections they have for their works. So intellectual property, in particular, copyright law, is something that there's a lot of mythology about, and there's a lot of pitfalls as well. So I think that's an area that we really try to make our artists understand, but also things like contract law. Many people in general don't recognize that, you know, they're entering into contracts all the time, and that most of those or many of those are negotiable. On the financial side of things, I think it's for many of us, it's a common problem to not be examining our own financial health. And so I don't know that artists are unique in their struggles with that, but because so many art forms, particularly at the early stages of their career, are not necessarily all that profitable, or you may not even be being paid for some of the things that you're doing, it's easy to sort of cover your eyes and put things on credit cards and not really pay attention to all of the costs that are associated with with your practice. And I think the risk for that is obvious, that you can get yourself into trouble, but also that when you don't look at the details, or you're afraid to look at the details, you can miss some wonderful opportunities to save money or even make money. Open a checking account, have a separate credit card, have a budget that really matches up with that. And that way you can keep your personal financial health from being dragged down potentially by your business. Now, the goal, of course, is that as a business, there too you will be solvent, and that you'll be able to manage what it is the outflow that you're spending.
So I guess what I would sort of say to everybody, to many artists who are beginning their careers, is to really take a week. 2 weeks, if you have the time, and sit down and analyze what every single expense is associated with your arts practice. At this point, you've seen patterns already. You know what kinds of materials you like to use. You see repeated expenses that come up again and again, and just set those aside. Write it down, make a budget, and see where you can start to cut costs. And if I could, I'd also add that, like many areas in the arts, the line that defines who is what is blurry. So, who is a curator? Under the right circumstances, you could be a curator as well. Now, if you see a space that you think that artwork would look good at, there's no reason why you can't approach whoever owns that space and propose that. So that if you were to work together to put on a group show, and we have plenty of examples of that, with artists that we've worked with, they will decide, hey, there aren't enough opportunities in our particular town. We've worked with communities in upstate New York, and there may not be as many gallery options there as there are in other parts of the state. And we've had groups of artists say, we're going to band together and create our own exhibition, and we will split the costs. So if you're looking at renting out a storefront, say to do an exhibition, and it costs $1,000, if that's split 15, 20 ways, that's a lot more manageable than doing it yourself. It makes the pressures for the success of that show a lot less. It's also 15 to 20 people who have their own personal networks that can come to the show. It's better marketing, it's better advertising, and it just enlarges your own sort of web network here. So I think other artists are a fantastic way of growing your career.
I think it's important for artists to have an understanding of what they're doing, not just that they're painting something or creating a beautiful image, but the thought that goes behind it, that they can express that to a gallery owner, or that they can express that to a collector who wants to know about their work, or to a museum person. But there has to be content that they can explain. I think that's very helpful for an artist, and helpful for them gaining recognition in any way.
The better an artist can articulate themselves and express their views about their work and be engaging with a public, it helps. it's certainly a way to be engaging, and because people love stories, collectors tend to be a little bit afraid of the visual world, and it's all rather intimidating. And in many ways, what we're doing is we're selling stories, and we're giving words to these visual images so that they can attach feelings to them. That when the artists can express themselves in a very cogent way, an engaging way, it certainly helps. So I think art schools do that a lot, in that they compel artists and really encourage artists to be able to articulate what they're doing and why they're doing it. Not everyone can do it, and it's certainly not a prerequisite to becoming a famous artist, but in this day and age, it doesn't hurt. If you're asking us to commit our resources and our energy to supporting your work as an artist, I want to know that you're fully engaged and that you get it. Because it's you know, that's part of it. And artists often can make one great body of work, but can they make two or three or four? And I often say it's the space between the work that defines an artist's career. It's that sort of thought process that leads them from body of work to body of work.
Over-demanding is, especially for a young artist, it's a deal-breaker. You know, being very entitled and demanding everything. Most gallery owners, if they're really good ones, work very hard for their artists. There's some that are not good, and that's a problem. But if it's a gallery owner who works hard for his artists and to try and give them the exposure that will help their career, that tries and give them input and helps to support and build them. Sometimes artists feel that because they're getting all this attention from the owner individually, they are entitled to everything. And the demands can become very unreasonable in terms of time, in terms of how much money you're going to spend on advertising them, in terms of how many museum exhibits you get for them in a year. Mm-hmm. Not an easy process to build the career of an artist. So it really needs teamwork with an artist that can be cooperative and understand what the stresses are for a gallery owner, and a gallery owner who can understand what the stresses are for an artist.
That at a bare minimum, you want to have some kind of representation of your work somewhere. So if people say, you know, hopefully a portfolio. You know, it doesn't need to be something that's printed beautifully and very expensive. You can have a website that just documents your work in some way. You basically want somebody who's interested in you, you know, to be able to see what you do. In terms of a requirement for that, there's no official requirement for anything. Some best practices and some good tips, I think, would be to make sure that your work is well represented. And I can't stress enough the importance of good photography, you know, when documenting work. So if you're, for example, a sculptor, you know, having photographs of your work that show it to scale, you know, that capture it in a space, you know, that aren't too blurred or don't represent it well or don't show the colors. You know, these are sort of basic things that we sometimes don't think about, that at a bare minimum, you want to have some kind of representation of your work somewhere. So if people say, you know, hopefully a portfolio. You know, it doesn't need to be something that's printed beautifully and very expensive. You can have a website that just documents your work in some way. You basically want somebody who's interested in you, you know, to be able to see what you do. In terms of a requirement for that, there's no official requirement for anything. Some best practices and some good tips, I think, would be to make sure that your work is well represented. I can't stress enough the importance of good photography, you know, when documenting work. So if you're, for example, a sculptor, you know, having photographs of your work that show it to scale, you know, that capture it in a space, you know, that aren't too blurred or don't represent it well or don't, you know, don't show the colors. You know, these are sort of basic things that we sometimes don't think about. I think a website is pretty cost effective and at this point pretty ubiquitous. So, you know, if you can find common spaces. Frankly, you could do it on Facebook. You know, it's not that hard to find somewhere online to put good images of your work so that if somebody shows interest in what you do, they can take a look at it. Have a business card as well, you know, with that web address.
As a dealer, I had wonderful experiences traveling the world, some rather frightening ones, some very funny ones, but it's a fascinating life. You meet interesting people if you're open to it. And I think that in today's market, so much is done on the internet that personal connections are really important. So it's important for gallery owners and for artists to make personal connections and develop relationships rather than relying on everything being technologically transmitted. There's something that happens, there's a magic that happens between people that you can't capture on a computer.
No, I mean, you know, the way in which the internet works is essentially about search and social. Okay, that's where the bulk of traffic comes from any site. Okay, beyond direct marketing, which is emails and other forms of marketing online, the audience really comes from social media and search. Okay, now it's very difficult to game that as a practicing artist looking to sell your work. There just aren't a lot of people searching for Bahrain contemporary art by now. Okay, so it's very, very difficult to game that. In terms of social media, well, the basket of factors that go into what makes something successful in social media, you know, it's complicated because it's really about entertainment. The things that kind of go viral don't tend to be those things that have a commercial, you know, endpoint. And so what you're looking at essentially is it's very, very difficult to market yourself as an artist online, whether you're living in Brooklyn or Bahrain.
So I think that artists tend to build communities with other artists that are in the same genre of work that they are. And it's a very good way of bouncing off ideas, sharing ideas, exploring, opening new areas. I mean, if you look at, for example, the group of artists in Europe during the period of Cubism, Picasso and Braque exchanging back and forth and bouncing ideas around. You feed on each other and you help each other grow. So I think for the artwork, that's important.
I think to network with other artists is one of the best things you can do. The notion of competition in the arts is really not something that we believe in at NYFA, and it's certainly not anything that I believe in personally either. Other artists are resources. You know, they're sources of inspiration, they're people you can learn from, they are people that you can bounce ideas off of, they are people who can, you can look at their resumes, you know, and just see the awards they've won or the places they've exhibited at, and it can give you ideas. I think they can also be fantastic collaborators.
You know, the last 15, 20 years is that actually gallerists have played the leading role. They function as patrons, as mentors, as agents and representatives, and they've really taken on a massive role. In some ways, I think that gallery and dealer kind of work in the US in the 50s and 60s was also much more of that kind of nurturing role.
And I believe in supporting young artists too, because they need support. They don't get it for the most part. So I think that a good gallery owner will really be committed to not only showing their artists, but being involved with their life, knowing what's going on, if they have a problem, trying to help. If they're not eating, making sure they get some food. You know, if they're having a problem with a place to stay and they can't pay the rent, helping them find a situation. I mean, just being a kind of a father or mother to your artists. You have to, a good gallery person will take care of their artists, not just their art.
But I think for that initial approach, there is no one right way to do it. I personally favor trying to make some sort of personal connection. If you can focus a bit, and we talk about this in our book, The Profitable Artist, if you can think about what you can do for them, you know, that's a, or to ask questions about what, you know, what brought them to where they're at. If somebody's at an opening, they're proud of that. Maybe they're nervous. You know, think about it from their perspective. So if you come up to somebody at what's their moment of triumph, and you're just trying to, you know, peddle your work, you know, maybe you'll get a reaction positively. I mean, there are many different personalities. Some people like that. But it's also, I think, pretty universal that everybody likes to be complimented. And everybody likes to be acknowledged, and everybody likes to have thoughtful questions about what they do. And so that can be a great way to start accessing somebody as an artist, as a curator, and as an individual. And then you can certainly segue into I'm an artist as well, and then begin the conversation that way. That would be my sort of best recommendation for a cold call.
I think community is probably the key to becoming known, and it's building that community, and it's really constructing it for yourself, because there's not it's not just there waiting to have you join. For a New York artist, or for a young artist coming to New York in particular, you're going to see you know, they're using their school contacts, their schoolmates from when they were in, you know, art school, and then like a kind of circle of friends that then become their sounding board. So long term, one relies on those people because they're the sort of, you can touch base with them. And before anyone's had any economic success, you know, everyone's on this sort of level playing field. Suddenly people enter into the art world and, you know, one guy or woman becomes very successful, and then the others maybe less so. Then there's a kind of schism in the relationship, perhaps, or you know, they're sort of at different levels or different playing fields at that moment. So, in the broadest way, how do you become known? You create community, and you really have to do it yourself, and you need to work towards that.
That would be another thing I would just throw out there, is that there are wonderful opportunities to collaborate cross-discipline that you know, that's becoming far more common now. But, you know, and frankly has been common when you think about it through the years. But as technology evolves and new media opens up, you know, there's almost always a need for what somebody else does. You know, musicians need people who understand, you know, the visual world in order to help represent their works on video, or in, you know, album covers, and, you know, any number of other areas. And, you know, conversely, you know, dance, you know, incorporates often many elements of set design and background art. You know, there are great stories throughout history, as I'm sure you know, of you know, artists and composers interpreting each other's work in their own mediums. So it you know, it can open up new audiences for you, and it can open up new creative paths for yourself. So I can't stress enough how important you know, having a strong community of artists can be. It is a network of support. It is a network of ideas.
And it is a shared shared community of interests. Any interest community has more power than an individual.
Am I sounding kind of Luddite? But I think so. I really do. I mean, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, like, sure. But nothing compares to this moment of being face-to-face, or some representative of this art world being face-to-face with somebody else. All we're trying to do with this kind of arts exchange is create moments where we recognize each other as similar and human and empathize and all of those things. And it's just, I don't think a Twitter or a video chat does it.
And I think that in today's market, so much is done on the internet that personal connections are really important. So it's important for gallery owners and for artists to make personal connections and develop relationships rather than relying on everything being technologically transmitted. There's something that happens. There's a magic that happens between people that you can't capture on a computer.
And while I think that what's happening in the region is super important, what I've learned more than anything else in working intensely with these communities over the last 4 years is that what's equally important is intra-regional dialogue and exchange, the different levels of development of art scenes can be a really exciting way to share knowledge, to share ideas, innovative new practices for shifting art sectors, kind of infrastructural kind of ecosystems and how they depend on each other. And then equally important is exchange with the rest of the world. And Europe is way in advance of the US in doing this kind of international arts exchange. And this is really what I spent the last 4 years trying to do. I think it's one of the most important things that the MENA arts sector needs is this kind of openness.
And I think the transmission of cultural values and political views through the visual arts can be very powerful. I mean, I'm not a big believer in that art is social engagement and that it's for social change, but I think, I do believe that it's a way of introducing ideas. And certainly if you look at Ai Weiwei and as this, you know, icon of Chinese rebellion, laced with all kinds of contradictions, because he's the most capitalistic, commercially motivated, and perhaps ungenerous person. Mm-hmm. Nonetheless, he represents something very important to the outside world about China and totalitarianism and oppression. So the layered message of, you know, what is the culture in Bahrain would be very interesting for people to know. Because I'm sure they have their own vernacular and their own set of images and stories that told in a kind of compelling visual way could be very interesting.
The reason I have continued to work with art, especially visual art, in this funny space that I've created for myself, space of being a connector between the Middle East and the U.S. is that it's non-polemical. It's non-political in the same way as a policy paper is.
I feel like you can put a piece of art in front of somebody and they bring something new to it in the process of looking at it and trying to understand it. It is a platform for dialogue. It is a place for thinking and seeing things that no New York Times article, as thorough and important as it may be, can communicate about the private lives of people, the private thoughts of these people who are so far away and so alien in our minds.
I think it makes me more opened and maybe more compassionate in an area that I might not have been, where I thought maybe I was, but there's certainly room to grow. If something's beautiful, it always sings in my heart for a long time.
I think art, like most forms of cultural activity, is about telling stories. And it's about narrating the experience of individuals in real time. So it's a form of lived history.
So it's just, you know, there are many stories. And I think the great works of art, it's my personal view, I'm not interested in necessarily art about art. I'm interested in art that extends into a richer cultural story that happens to be beautiful. Because I think it all starts with beauty, and once you're engaged in the work of art as an aesthetic experience, and you're compelled to dig deeper, then you want to know more. There's more to be known.
I think artists have a really special perspective on the world, and visual artists, you know, present an image of the world that you miss if you're not, you know, privileged to see what they've created. But I think artists are among the most perceptive people in sort of interpreting the world, and I've always thought, you know, that visual arts in particular have an immediacy that is, you can't duplicate with anything else. A novel can take 500 pages to make a point that, you know, sometimes a painting can make in one long look. I mean, I keep, you know, picking Renaissance examples, but say Michelangelo's Last Judgment, which is, you know, sort of an overpowering vision. I mean, not all art rises to that particular level, but I think a lot of it has that effect on you. And I always think, you know, a visual artist, if the visual artist could explain everything in words, he or she would probably be a writer rather than an artist. There's something about someone who knows how to create objects and images that's, you know, very special and very unusual. And if you open yourself to it, you can have experiences that you can't have any other way. So, you know, I would say three cheers for art. So,
I think art is such a necessity for both the enrichment of the heart and human soul, as well as for the percolation of the mind. I think artists tend to be a seismograph for things in the future, whether they're cultural trends, cultural perspectives. Artists somehow have their ear to the rail, and I think they foreshadow the direction of human endeavor.